Hey George, Larry Palmer and Paula Palmer, neighbors and ex-student. You know, it's kind of interesting, George, just a couple of minutes ago, people at the table were talking about instructors and professors and teachers who had a significant impact on their lives. I mentioned that I had three. One in high school, an English instructor at Wayne by the name of Sharples, I don't know if you know him, and you. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart. I can't tell you the number of times that the value that I picked up in being part of the debate team and knowing you as an individual has come back repeatedly. Thank you very, very much for everything you've done for us.
By the way, I remember the first time I got an article rejected, and I went into George's office, the first article I'd ever gotten rejected, and I was so depressed. And I went into his office with the rejections, and I said, I'm crushed, it's just awful, I hate my work. And he pulled out the reviews, he started reading, he found a couple of good lines. He said, no, they don't hate you. Look, they said something good here. That made me feel a lot better.
Well, I credit George Ziegelmueller with my ability to speak in front of an audience. George was my professor of Speech 101. And as I recall the course, George, at the end of the course, told me that my first speech was probably one of the worst speeches he'd ever heard. But at the end of the course, he said, it's amazing the transition you've made. And I joined the debate team and was a novice debater, and we finished third at Bellarmine. So that was a cool thing. To this day, I credit George Ziegelmueller with my ability to speak in front of people.
George Ziegelmueller, amazing, amazing man. Ed, I'm sure he's just as proud to know you as you are to know him.
Oh. George was not even 30 yet, and he was finishing up his degree at Northwestern, and he came to Wayne in 1957. I met him in his class. I was a student of his.
Really?
I was a student.
You were a grad student.
I was a grad student working on a PhD.
Right.
And, well, I figured, well, I'm a debate coach. This will be a snap course for me.
Yeah, right.
Oh, boy, did I find out different.
Right.
We had to write a paper every week on some aspect of argument and advocacy. And I got my only B from George. George was a hands-on coach. I mean, he had a lot of practice debates. He really had his people prepared, and they were very effective, and they would be winning debates and tournaments.
George brought home more trophies than all these big name football
all
coaches.
All you have to do is go up into the fifth floor of Manugin,
and
he's got trophy cases full of trophies.
Tell us about the man himself.
The man himself was very humble, devoted to this activity, one of the most analytical minds I ever met. His PhD dissertation was incredibly dull. It was a rhetorical analysis of speakers in the New Deal. He was very interested in his students, which is partially why his program, I think, had unusual success. He became a mentor and a personal friend more than he became our coach. He was probably only 10 years older than we were when he first came here. He always looked younger than his years. He was the anchor for the program, not just here, but almost everywhere in the country.
And his program was, compared to most other programs, more systematic, bigger, because we always had big teams, not just a handful of students. A lot of the East Coast schools did have good teams, but their coaches spent all of their time on the top four or six debaters. Here we had 20 or 25 debaters, and George and his team of debate coaches would spend, you know, time with all of us, all the debaters, to make a big program.
The big thing you quickly picked up from George was hard work. He worked hard. You know, people think and talk about practice debates, but they don't realize that many of those were 8 and 10 o'clock at night, and it was 5 and 6 and 7 days a week, and maybe even down on a Saturday to have them, and he was there all the time. I know of no professor anywhere in the university, and I've known a lot of them, that put in the type of time that George did. And once your coach was doing it, it was pretty hard to not do it yourself.
Sure, he would pit two students against two students, affirmative and negative, and you debate. As a student, rate George as a teacher.
As a teacher, a 10 for sure. He's tough.
Why do we remember the tough ones? You know, why do we?
They push you. They push you to do more than you know you can do, or even initially that you do. Like you put out stuff you think it's pretty good, and they say no, that's not good enough. Do better.
He wouldn't settle for anything but your best effort.
Mm-hmm.
Fascinating thing about George is, despite all this rapid success story, rapid rise, and the kind of a man that has a reputation that's unsurpassed, and yet he's just the most down-to-earth person I can imagine. Even later years, I remember George. We had a forensic activity, the awards day, the Delta Sigma Rho party. And everybody's here, and just chatting around, and here's George sitting on a stage, just sitting there. You know, here's a man who could have commanded the just so down to earth and so genuine.
Well, he was a man who was extremely humble. He came from Indianapolis. He was a dyed-in-the-wool Hoosier, and I think he went to DePauw University for his undergrad. Then he went to Southern Illinois, and from there he went to Northwestern. And integrity, he had real integrity. I mean,
sure.
He was a real person, as you say.
Right, right.
Never impressed by his own press clippings.
Right. It blew my mind to meet a professor of such renown who lets us call him George.
Well, he was either George or Ziggy. That was it.
Amazing man.